Okay, guys, back at the airport, and this time we're going to be going up to Minocqua, Wisconsin, and I've got some friends coming up. They're going to be bringing their kids, and I think we're going to be doing a little survival training. It'll be fun. How to start a fire with your bare hands. Let's see if I can even do it. I think I can. Speaking of starting a fire, there's some fire coming out of that thing. Anyway, come on along. It's gonna be a good time. On. Cool. Donuts here. Treats. We're good. 0.6. Those are the two key things to look out for. So we're going to hit the starter now. Nobody's near us. And we have our hand here ready to put this into low idle. We're watching our NG to level out. Usually at about 17. We'll introduce the fuel. Now we're going to watch the ITT and the back to the NG. Or a hot start or a hot start. There's the first light up. We're going to keep the starter in. It's over 50. Okay, we got a good start. We're going to turn the fuel boost to normal and the alternator standby on. Everything's good. We got oil pressure, oil temperature's good. We've got fuel flow. We're going to go to high idle, turn the air conditioner on, along with the avionics.
All right, we are good to go. Almost. How's it going, everybody? We are heading back to Minocqua. Have some fun up there. We got a VFR day. Beautiful VFR day. A little headwind, but who cares about that? Oshkosh is in full swing. And we're going to be flying just outside their airspace, transitioning from Waukegan here to Lakeland Airport, Minocqua. Still looks good. All right, so let's set our course. Let's do flight plan. GN, it's a pretty simple one today. K Alpha Romeo Victor. It's Lakeland Airport. Here we go. That'll be it for that. And our altitude, you know what, we're gonna go up to even altitude plus 500, so let's go to 8500. We don't have huge headwinds, and that's going to be set up right in that window there. 5. Let's listen to ATIS. I know what's going on out here.
Waukegan Tower Information, Whiskey, 1155 Zulu weather. Wind calm, visibility 10, sky condition clear. Temperature 17, dew point 14, altimeter 3017.
Alpha Victor, Waukegan Tower, runway 23, taxi,
Bravo, Alpha.
Crosswind 3 at Bravo, crosswind 32.
Partially Charlie closed between Charlie 3 and the north rim. Grass cutting operations are under effect. All aircraft use caution. Read back all hold short instructions and runway assignment. Information, Whiskey.
Waukegan ground, Amphib Caravan is departing to the northwest. We're right under you with Whiskey.
Caravan 188 Foxtrot, Waukegan ground, taxi to runway 23 via Mike 2, Bravo, Alpha, cross runway 14.
Mike 2 on Bravo, over to Alpha, crossing runway 14. Waukegan Tower, Caravan, Amphib Caravan 180 Foxtrot 23, ready to go.
Amphib Caravan 180 Foxtrot, Waukegan Tower, runway 23, clear for takeoff, proceed on course.
23, clear for takeoff, 80 Foxtrot. Follow the yellow line, follow the yellow brick road. Traffic coming into the from the right. That happened to me once before. Yeah, I was looking. All right, let's get the takeoff power set. Right there, we keep it a little below red line because the ram effect is going to increase it.
Mike 2.
All right, we're approaching V1.
Now,
rotate.
4-8, cross taxi for Bravo to approach here, runway 350 area.
4-8, Roger.
Gear up, flaps up. Looking good. Let's turn out of the possible wake turbulence.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down this unfamiliar road. And although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone. 'Cause I'm gonna make this place your home. Settle down, it'll all be clear. Don't pay no mind to the demons, they fill you with fear. The trouble, it might drag you down.
So as you can see here, we're intercepting the main approach course for runway 36 at Lakeland Airport. It's really amazing. Accuracy, 25 feet vertical horizontal, 95% of the time. So as we come down, here's a repeat of the intercept. You can see the needle coming in. And look to the upper right at the glide slope. There's a purple diamond. There it comes down. And when it hits that dot, that bottom dot right there, that's when we drop our landing gear, because when it centers up and we start descending, then our gear's down. And that drag is going to make up and slow us down for that descent, along with backing off some of the power. And boy, it just comes right in with that accuracy right down to the runway. Minimums are 1948 feet sea level here, which is 321 feet above the ground. And that is about there, so you can see how low we are. And even with some turbulence and some wind, that RNAV GPS system holds it right to the runway.
'cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
Hey, hey, here we go. Survival time. Guys, you ready?
Yeah.
You ready to learn survival?
No.
Now, what happens if your plane engine goes out and you have to parachute out into the wilderness and you've got nothing on you and you're freezing at night?
Make a fire.
Make a fire, that's right. And this is about, there's a lot of different survival techniques and all kinds of things to survive, but what we're going to talk about tonight is just how to make a fire. So let's start, before we start, actually, we've got to do the oath. Repeat after me. Mecca-lecca hi, Mecca-johnny ho.
What?
All right, let's try it again. Mecca-lecca hi, Mecca-hiney ho.
Okay, let's try again. Mecca-lecca hi, ho.
All right, all together. Mecca-lecca hi, Mecca-hiney ho. Mecca-lecca hi, Mecca-johnny ho. Okay, you're now Pee Wee Herman official. All right, so who knows what this is? Let's see.
There's a bug.
Okay, what's this?
A lighter.
So if you're in the woods, great. How to make a fire, right? What if this doesn't work? What if you don't have this? What's the next thing you're going to do?
Find wood.
Well, you're going to find wood. Now, the nice thing, the cool thing is, let's just say that we have a few things. We'll work from the top down, the easiest down. So if you don't have a lighter, another cool thing to do is use what's called fire steel. Now, if you go to Sport Mart or Dick's, they have these things from Coleman. So this is a magnesium. Boy Scouts have this. You may have seen this, Owen. And this has a magnesium. What you do is you take your knife and you can take the magnesium. This is like fire starting. And you can shave off, see those little silver things?
Yeah.
And then what you do is you gather them all together and then you take this, and this is the fire starter, and you make sparks with this. But you'll see that the stuff that you buy, this is really, really not good, because the stuff they're selling is so terrible that it hardly works. Who can start a fire with that? So that's what they're selling. But if you go to if you go online and get the good stuff, this is actually made by Doan Mock Company, and they are in Euclid. I don't know where they're at, but anyway, let me just show you the difference. This is called fire steel. Look at that. Whoa. Look at that. So the whole idea is you can shave off with your knife. This is magnesium. And then you put the sparks. We're not going to do it here because it would start the table on fire. But then if you want to really go high end, this is a really cool fire starter. Look at this. It has cotton fire starting material. So you take a piece out and then you take this and then you go, everybody get back. Look at that. So you put it all here and then you're just doing this. Boom, look at it, it's like 4th of July. So this is a great thing to carry with you. And what the guys in Alaska do is they actually, I'm gonna show you what are good things to start fires with. Well, do you guys know what fat wood is?
No.
Okay.
Wood that's fat?
Yeah, if you get fat. So actually, this is a pine tree. Now, when pine trees lose their branches down low, it's kind of like they send like a fireman, and they send the sap to cover. It's like if you get a wound and you put a Band-Aid on it to stop the bleeding, what they do is if you break this branch off, like when this branch broke off, it sent all of this stuff called this red sap there to patch the hole like syrup. And what's left is when you if you go look in the woods, and if we were to saw this off, and I'm not going to saw it off right here, you're going to find this fat wood. You can actually see here, it's like red, and that's what you're looking for. You're looking for little stubs like this in the woods as you're hiking along. Because remember, when you're in trouble and you're surviving, it's not like the drugstore where you can pick stuff off the shelves. As you're hiking, you need to think, and you need to bless you. Again, there we go. You need to like look for this stuff as you're walking, so you can break off a piece of that. And basically, what if you buy it at the store? This is fat wood for the fireplace, so you can actually use this. You know what I did? Is I took this kind of stuff. I took my knife. And then I would split a piece like this, and then I would put this in the pencil sharpener, and that would make a pencil that doesn't write. But the cool thing about this is that's why I have these Altoids things, because then I took all the shavings and I put them in here. Check this out. Look at that. Now that's fat wood. Now if I put that here, we can try it real quick. I'll put it on this stone. I don't know if it'll work because we've got a lot of wind here. But if I were to do this fire starting, I don't know if it'll work. You know, it's pretty windy. But everybody get back, and I'll try to.
Are you trying to burn it?
Yep. Yeah. See, it starts on fire. See that? So that's how you can start a fire.
It's a mini fire for dogs.
Okay. And of course, you want to have your other sticks and stuff ready to put on that. That's your ember. So that's fat wood. And all that comes from these even living trees. When you see these little stumps where it broke off, inside here, there's just a ton of fat wood. Okay. So that's the fat wood thing. Now, another guy's, the guys in Alaska, they're snowmobiling, the guys in Alaska, they're on their dog sleds, and all of a sudden they're on a lake and they go underwater. It's 30 degrees below zero. And they keep, you know, this is a pill for pills. What they do is they put some cotton in there and some matches, and they always keep that on their body. So if that happens, because they only have like 5 minutes to get those wet clothes off, and they got to get a fire starter, they're going to die. So they take this off. Now, another cool thing you can take is if you take petroleum jelly or Vaseline, and you put that, where's the other Altoids? And you put that on cotton balls. Look at that. I've got 8 of them there. If you don't have that, what if you don't have anything?
Get wood.
You get wood, but how are you going to start the fire? That's the trick. So the other thing, the way that and all the people in the wilderness, what they do is they use sticks, and it's called, you know, making friction. So what you can do is there's three parts to it, really. One is you want to have what's called a hearth board, which is your bottom part. And what you do is you use your pocket knife and you drill a hole like this. And then you cut a notch, and this is where you're going to put your kindling. It's going to be a little windy to do this today, but I can get some smoke going. And then the middle part is you get a really straight stick, and you just kind of whittle away, and you make one side long and pointy, and the bottom part that you're going to use for the hole is you don't make it as pointy, you make it more round, because this is the friction part. And you can put, you don't want this to burn, or, you know, if you can avoid it. And then you need a top part. And you want to get a piece of wood that's not dry, like something that's green, and that's not going to cause friction. And make a little hole with your knife. You know, just like all you do. And that's, this is the most important thing in survival, is have a knife with you. Probably the number one thing.
I thought you said nothing.
No, I'm saying we do have, if you have anything, your knife is your number one thing. But we have nothing. So who said that? That's great. That's a great point. So how would you do all this if you had nothing? Well, you use rocks. Look at that. Isn't that a point? So you can get your hole started with rocks. And if you don't have a rock like this, you can throw it on another rock, and all of a sudden, chances are you're going to find something that's pointy. And that's all I did. I dropped this and And all you need to do is get it started. So the way this works is you have, and then the other thing you need to do to get this thing, because what you want it to do is you want to get it spinning really fast, right? And you're going to step on here, and I'm going to show you how we do that. And then, so you have a bottom part, I'm going to use this one. And then you have the top part, and that's going to hold it. You hold this in your hand like that. And then we need, how are we going to turn this thing really fast? Well, that's the last part. And this looks like a bow and arrow, right? But it's really not a bow and arrow. It's something where we're going to use, we're going to use it to spin. So we go in the woods, and what do we find? We're looking for any stick that's curved. Okay, see these, and they don't have to be really curved a lot, just a little bit of a curve. And then what I do is I make notches with my knife in the top. See that? Make like a notch, and then what you can do is you need to have string, but you said nothing. So if we don't have the string, where could we get string? And here's the thing, when you're in a tough situation, you need not panic. You need to think, I'm gonna be positive. I'm gonna think of everything I can think of, and I'm gonna make a game out of it. Like, where can I get string? I don't have string. I didn't bring my paracord. All I've got are these sticks, and I didn't even have a knife. I had to use a rock to kind of get these things ready. Well, you look down at your feet, and what do we have? We have shoelaces.
I know, but what if you have strap shoes?
You have, what?
What if you have strap shoes?
Okay, well, let's say we have strap shoes. Let's say we have no string. I mean, you got to think first, what do I have on me? Well, you could take your t-shirt off, and you could cut it into thin strips, and then stretch it, and then wind it and twist it, and that can become a string. Another way you could do it is you can find willows. Now this is, I just cut this about 2 hours ago. And I took my knife, and what I did is I cut a slit right down the middle like this. See that slit that I made? And then what you do is, and always keep your hands away, is look at, see the bark? Now what we're going to do is, look at this, this is fresh green, it's living, I cut this, you know, if you're going to break, you know, I cut it, but you're going to break this off, and then what you're going to do is you're going to peel the bark back, see that, and you can take this whole bark, you can get a nice long piece of bark, you know, I made my cut with my knife here, so what I'm going to do is then make another cut. Let's see, where is it? Cut. And what I'm going to do is make another cut alongside that. Now we got to watch our fingers. Always want to cut away. And you want to go about a quarter inch. See that? Myself. Okay. See that? There's your string. Mm. So what you can do is, I'll just show you really quick. You got this piece, and then what we got to do is, for demo purposes, I'm going to get right on the table. Put your foot on here. Okay. We put that there, and then what we're going to do is, what you do is you attach that to the stick, and you put it like this around like that. Okay. Now the way that it is, they would hold this on this side, and instead of, you know, I don't have three hands. What would you do? So you use your mouth, and you have a block of wood in your mouth like this. And what they do is they kind of use their knee. Let's see if I can do this. This is going to be my first time trying this. Okay. They put this like this. Then they get this on here. Okay. Probably get a little thicker piece, and that's how you can do it. But the better way to do it is if you have your paracord with you, and they have bracelets you can buy that have 9 feet of paracord. You can buy them for like $5. Amazon. You wear it like a bracelet. You get in trouble, you pull that off. 9 feet of this stuff. You make your notch. You leave it a little loose. Because what we're going to do here is use your foot. Use that. I'm going to wind it on here. I'm going to wind it twice. And by the way, it works better if this thing's really wet. I'm going to make this with my saliva. I'm going to wind it like that. I'm going to wind it twice. See that? Alright, now the pointy side, I'm going to go up. There it is. And then where's our block? Where's that block? Watch you guys spread apart. Actually, I'll do it this way. Okay, see that? Everybody see that?
Yeah.
You just kind of go easy at first. And then you start picking up speed. And it, oops. And it's all about the friction. You can see that's already getting hot. So let's see if we can get this going. That's how you start the fire. You put an ember in there, you get all your stuff ready, and you dump it in your little ember. That's how you do it. Okay, any questions? And I'm out of breath. All right, that's your fire survival, that was guys. All right, now you know what to do.
When the zombies hit, do not die.
All right.
Traffic, Amphib Caravan 18 Sierra Foxtrot, departing 18 Southeast Lakeland. Traffic, no traffic. Coyotes on the runway, no deer on the ramp. The time I took off, I had two coyotes on the runway come right in front of me. What do you do? Well, you engage 30 degrees of flaps and pull up if you're even a little too slow and try to just lift it over them. Whatever you can do. You can't dodge them left or right. Okay, let's go up to full power. We're going to go up to red line. We're going to keep it just below red line. Well, maybe not just below because the ram air effect is going to take over. Coming up on V1. positive rate, gear up, degrees off. Looking good, managing our power.
Lakeland Memorial, traffic bearing 287 kilo mic. We're about 8 miles to the southeast, Lakeland traffic.
Okay, so we have traffic coming right at us, so we're gonna let them know what we're doing. And I see them here on the Lakeland traffic. Caravan is off 18 southeast, directly at you. I think we're going to be a little west of you, and we're at 1900 climbing.
We're now 6 miles, and we are passing through 4300.
Okay, we'll straighten out to the south a little.
Okay.
All right, so we're going to deviate about 20 degrees to the right. We've got somebody coming in right on our path. It would definitely be a collision course. Should say possible collision course. We're going to be looking for him. Lakeland traffic, Caravan 182 Foxtrot, out of 2500 climbing just to the west edge of Lake Minocqua. And there he is. And we have the traffic, 82 Foxtrot.
Sounds good.
Okay, that's not a factor anymore, so we can go back. We're going to reorient our direct to autopilot on. We're going to go to a nav mode, and we can just hit our VS for a climb on our altitude, and let's go up at 700, and now everything's all set with the autopilot. Here you can see way up there is 11,500. The little boxes indicate the course.
Lakeland traffic bearing 287 kilo mics over the field, entering a right downwind 18. Lakeland traffic.
Waukegan Harbor, is this some for a harbor? I think it is. All right. Gonna start bringing flaps in. We're about 5 miles out. At Waukegan Tower, 1880 Foxtrot Caravan. We're 5 out, ready to turn.
Caravan 1880 Foxtrot, runway 23, clear to land.
23, clear to land, 1880 Foxtrot. Will be signature.
Signature.
Alright, landing gear down. Autopilot off. Lower down.
Cessna 42 Foxtrot.
Hop forward.
Turn right. Crescent turn left at Alpha 5 and taxi the air bear via Alpha. This frequency. Good day, sir.
Turn left on Alpha 5. Taxi to air bear on Alpha. Remain on this frequency and good day to you. Thanks. 42 Foxtrot.
Winds are 230, so they're pretty much straight in our face, or as reported. We're not going to go full flaps because we have a lot of turbulence and gusting winds. So we're just going to do 20 degrees flaps. Alright, clear for 2-3. Gas is good. Undercarriage firm down.
Cessna 172 with
prop, stick forward, seatbelts, and lights. Yep. Yeah, just a hair more. Maybe 22 or 23 degrees. Alright, airspeed 95. Bring it down just a little bit. Want to be about 85. Alright, we're all set up. Everything's good.
Traffic.
Flaps up.
This is the 172 Whiskey Fox on runway 23 is in use.
Traffic.
Actually, you can make it 188 in time, sir. Affirmative. Caravan 1880 Foxtrot, taxi straight ahead into signature via Bravo to Mike 2.
Bravo Mike 2, 80 Foxtrot, thanks. Hey, there's a
Cessna
Skyraider here parked. Check that out, guys.
Cessna 180 on Alpha. Got that?
Yeah, I saw a couple.
That was a plane I was looking at getting instead of the Avenger, but I for crazy maintenance.
I saw a couple warplanes back there. It looked like it was some warplanes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we're going to definitely check out this Douglas A-1 Skyraider. Check this out. Folding wings. Look at the armaments. 6,000 pounds this thing could carry just in armaments alone. So this was a Navy Air Force Marine plane designed in the later stages of World War II, actually first flight 1945, and kind of took over for the TBM Avenger and fought in the Korean War, Vietnam War. Look at that engine, a Wright R3350 duplex cyclone radial, later upgraded. And look at this thing, even bombs underneath, just weapons everywhere. Optimized for ground attack missions, this thing was armored against grounds fire. It was known to take some punishing hits and keep flying. And it was some airplane. Actually, it also had underwing rockets and 2, but then later 4 20 millimeter cannons. So just amazing. Love the paint scheme. This one is based here at Waukegan Airport. A guy who has a whole bunch of military planes. And look at that. And single pilot plane. Actually, this thing was fitted with twin rockets for the pilot seat for ejection purposes. So you know what? Production ended in 1957. A total of 3,180 been built. And thank you for your service. Hey guys, stay tuned for the next video. We're actually going to be going to this place called Long Island, not to be confused with New York, Long Island. This place is up in northern Wisconsin on Lake Superior. It's a peninsula about 4 miles long. It's got some cool beaches and we're going to be doing some exploring. And it's got this Long Island Light Station, it's called. It was built in 1858 and it used to guide ships of the fur trade. So it should be cool. So stay tuned if you can.